Hey guys, this is Ink Escape, coming to you with Storytime for Nerds, a podcast dedicated to telling you, my fellow nerdy people, the stories that you want to hear. Now, without any further ado, let's grab our drink of choice and dive right in. When we last left our story, a young woman was sitting on a rooftop as the sun sets over the city. Her name is Callan. She is wearing medical scrubs as she continues to sit, her back against a chimney. Her curly brown hair is tucked under the hood of a sweatshirt she's wearing. The dying light of the day is being overtaken by the shadow of the mountains behind the city. Wind sweeps from the crimson pines forest through the foothills of the city and to her perch, causing some hair to pull free, but she pays it no mind. She keeps her eyes locked on the man sitting in the cafe. He sits in the bay window, playing a game on his comm watch, completely unaware of her eyes upon him. It would be so easy for Callan to climb down from this rooftop, ignore her suspicions about this man, and go back to work. But that is not who she is. Recently, she has been seeing dozens of young men at work, which is bad news for them considering she is a medical examiner by trade. Her job is to figure out how they all have died. And she has finally done it. All of the young men have tested positive for a terrible drug designed to create long-term suffering and eventual death. Callan shifts position, feeling her armored vest press against her ribs. Callan's husband is a police officer and allowed her to use it for occasions like this. She silently prayed it wouldn't be necessary. She turns her focus back to the man in the window. His name is Michael, an old friend of hers from college. She thinks back to the most recent body, who she had seen with Michael just simply days before he had wound up on her metal tray. But that wasn't the only thing. There was also the matter of... Callan clenched her jaw as she stood. She walked to the edge of the roof and felt the wind gust again. Please, dear God, let me be wrong. Stepping over the edge, she lets herself fall to the street below. Michael sits on the crooked stool of Grandma Adder's cafe, his favorite place. He knows the owner of this cafe. Grandma Adder had been in his neighborhood and known him since he was a child, and they had worked together to buy this place outside the slums of Granite City. Grandma Adder had thought she would need to go to the low-income housing that was one step above the street. Michael had given her money so she can buy this cafe and earn her way out of the slums. He takes a sip of tea as he plays the war game on his comm watch, the holographic screen lighting up with controls. The physical watch itself is no more than a thin black band making a figure eight around his forearm, projecting the screen right above it. He tries to keep himself calm as he awaits his customer. The cafe is nearly deserted this evening, and Michael enjoys the peace and quiet of the place. Sure, it's a bit run down and lackluster, but it serves a damn good cup of tea and sweet baked goods that were guaranteed to take 10 years of a man's life in pure, buttery deliciousness. Suddenly, he sees a small figure in a black hoodie past the window. He straightens immediately and tries to look down the sidewalk. But by the time he does so, the figure is gone. Shrugging, Michael settles back on the stool, chastising himself. Why am I so jumpy tonight? Michael thinks to himself. It's not like I'm doing anything new. He uses the toe of his shoe to scoot a small backpack further under his seat, staring briefly at it. The drug inside the backpack was his ticket out of the slums. and the reason why he was able to partly fund Grandma Adder's cafe. It had taken him many years of chemistry study and several trials, but he had finally done it. He had invented a drug as addictive as meth and toxic as rat poison. Finding people to use it on, though, had been easy enough. Michael smirks to himself as he thinks of the tortured expression on his latest victim's face as he had overdosed. Every single one of his victims was a member of a gang called the Heathens. It was the gang which ruled over the slums with an iron fist, often recruiting young boys to join their ranks. Now, they were paying dearly for making Michael's used-to-be home hell while he was growing up. He stretches, checking his handsome reflection in the window, and unconsciously reaches to his back, thinking of the tattoo that would soon be there. The drug had served him two purposes. One was to hunt down the heathens and kill them. But the other was to gain entry into an organization that boasted real change. Michael's Gramps had once been a part of an organization called Nimbus. Highly secretive, extremely powerful, and even better funded, Nimbus was the secret police of the world, according to his grandfather. Nimbus was the silent shadow that made things go right when all threatened to go wrong. Michael had wanted to gain entry into Nimbus since he was a child, constantly hearing stories about it from his grandfather. The drug and the blood of the heathens had been his test. Today, he had received a message saying, "A storm is coming." The message had also included a time and a place to meet his Nimbus contact the following day. "Things are finally turning around for me." A man comes into the cafe. He is dressed in clothing which hangs on his narrow frame. His eyes are bloodshot and slightly sunken in. He nods meaningfully at Michael and leaves, turning down the alley behind the cafe. Michael sighs, wishing he has time to finish his tea. He stands and goes to refill his cup with water.
"Wait a while before drinking that, man. That water is supposed to be cooling, not supposed to be drunk for another hour. We overheated it," says the teen behind the counter.
"How old is it?" asks Michael as he places his lid back on top. The plastic immediately warps from the heat and Michael quickly removes it.
"It was over the legal limit by 30 degrees when we remembered to take it out. We just took it out a few minutes ago," replies the kid, his face concerned, but Michael waves him away.
He begins to hum tunelessly to himself as he exits the cafe. The back of the building is a dark alleyway with a large dumpster. The hum of hoover cycles can be heard above occasionally. It smells of old food, coffee grounds, and smoke mixed with dry night air. Damien, Michael's customer, is leaning against the dumpster, trying to light a cigarette. Though he makes many attempts, his hands are shaking too much to strike the igniter. The lighter drops from his grasp, hitting the pavement with a clack. As he bends to pick it up, Michael rounds the corner, holding his cup in one hand, and his backpack, carried like a briefcase, in the other. He sits it down on the pavement, looks disapprovingly at his now empty hand, and wipes it on his jeans. Damien looks at the new arrival while he is still bent down. He quickly straightens and tucks the lighter into his pocket, cigarette forgotten. Michael grins wolfishly, showing many of his white teeth.
"Well, hello there, Damien. Need a light?" asks Michael with a lighthearted tone.
Damien's frown deepens, and he takes an unconscious step behind the dumpster.
"Not from you,"
he replies coolly. Michael shrugs, his posture relaxed.
"Whatever you say, shall we?" asks Michael.
Damien's frown becomes a scowl now,
about that. How close am I? I can't play anymore, man. I don't have the cash. Just don't. I...
He says, his body leaning forward, eyes flickering to the backpack, and his arms stretching slightly toward it. But Michael is already shaking his head.
You accepted the risk when you took your first dose,
says Michael, in a tone that broaches no argument.
Here we go again,
he thinks.
Might happen next dose. Might never happen. I can't tell. The stronger your body is and the more of it you can consume, your odds go up. Yeah, but I need something to show for it. It's been... I don't know how long. But I need something to change. And you said you knew the signs. Do I have any?
Damien straightens up, his face looking more sallow. Michael feels a shard of irritation and chuckles darkly.
We've had this discussion, Michael says. I'd need answers, man. I'm giving this everything I have.
Damien goes on, his eyes shining. He takes a small step forward, almost aggressively.
So, you just need to prove you're enough. I don't control what the drug does to you once you've taken it.
Michael replies coldly. He stands to his full height, knowing it casts a long shadow. Michael is a tall man. Damien is not. Damien starts to cry, cutting lines in the thin layer of dirt on his skin. He is shaking, and soft hiccuping sobs escape his lips. Michael is completely unaffected by this show. Damien had tried being pathetic at their last meeting to get some free doses of the drug, stating the same excuses. They all seemed to degrade very rapidly when the drug reached this point in their system. All of the heathens had seemed to deteriorate, one after the other. Damien was just the next in a very long line. Michael starts to feel a shard of sympathy for him, until flashes go across his mind. His mother crying as a backhand connects with her mouth. His kid brother being pushed into a wall so hard the drywall caves in. Money being taken from his mom's meager savings in a cookie jar she stores her tips in. The heathens were responsible for it all, and so much more. Michael shakes his head, refusing to feel sorry for these bastards, always hungry for power, who believe in false miracles.
Well, says Michael, you honestly don't seem to have any signs. It's another dud unless you think you have a little bit more in you. If not, I can't do anything for you. Not everybody can be more than human.
Damien's hands shake even harder, and his eyes somehow grow more bloodshot. Michael had designed the drug to become more painful the more distant you grew from it. The only relief from the pain was the high of yet another dose of the drug. Everything else paled in comparison.
No, 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 no.
Damien utters, still shaking his head.
There's gotta be more. I tried. Didn't I give? No. Please?
He asks, sounding as if he were speaking to himself. Michael sighs and checks his watch.
You know, I have other places to be. Are you buying or no?
Damien peeks his head up at him, tears coming down his cheeks still.
He makes a small, growling sound. That's bullshit, asshole. You have to tell me how much more I have to do, man, till...
He says, pausing to draw rattling breaths.
You're acting like a gremlin. Come on, stop. Stop embarrassing yourself. Just tell me how long I have till...
Till you're like my kind? Until you develop a subtlety? A superpower? Michael asks, and Damien nods in reply. Michael slowly rotates his hands in the air, letting light glint off rings on his fingers in the low light.
I've already explained this to you, and I won't do it twice. Pay up, or I'm gone, and your chances of being more than human walk with me.
Michael takes a sip of his tea. You want to be able to do this?
And then he drinks it like it's cold, the hot liquid going down his throat smoothly, with absolutely no pain. Michael breathes in and blows out a huge cloud of steam that extends high into the air. It hisses as it hits the colder air.
You want to be able to drink water fresh from boiling? You want this? You're pathetic.
Michael smiles at Damien, his white teeth seeming to glow. He lets the heat within him expand and every breath come out in a steam cloud. Damien's eyes widen, but instead of fear, Michael sees an expression of deepest longing on his face. After a beat of silence, Michael shakes his head.
This was a waste of time. Don't ask for a free dose again. If you do, you will find my response even less kind.
Michael says, in a note of finality, adjusting his coat. It was done. Damien's fate was sealed. Eventually, the drug would overtake him. His body would stop working. The drug would attack his nervous system, causing a decrease of blood flow to every single nerve, causing excruciating pain. It was just a matter of time. Michael's only regret is he can't get Damien to pay for his poison one more time. He stares into Damien's ugly, bloodshot eyes with disgust, then picks up the backpack and turns away.
Until he hears a familiar sound.
Michael stops where he stands.
Now what, genius?
With some effort, Michael relaxes, and once again adopts the expression of a cool disappointment. As he turns, Damien is leveling a gun at him, head height. It is a cheaper gun, but it will still do what it's built for. Damien's face is tipped down in determination and aim. Michael curses inwardly and continues with his only course of action. Lies. It's just like one of his grandfather's favorite sayings.
If you're going to hell, might as well tip your hat to old Inverni on the way in. Man, I think you've been lying to me from the start. You think I'm gonna take your shit lying down? Give me the damn bag and you better hope that shit works.
Damien demands, jerking the barrel of the gun toward the backpack and then back to Michael. His eyes are almost entirely red now.
What's that toy supposed to do, buddy?
Michael says, relaxing his shoulders. Damien hesitates.
There was a time when your kind feared humans. We hunted you and used you. Now I see why. It's bullshit that y'all get to walk around like nothing, using natural, normal people. Many people forgot y'all exist. Bullshit!
Damien says, gesturing the gun again, a deadly gleam in his eyes. Michael's mind whirs, and he can only pray that Damien keeps talking.
You said you saw something in us, the heathens. You said you could get us powers, man. But now, most of us is either dead, in jail, or in the hospital because of you! You fucking traitor!
Michael forces himself to keep relaxed, a tentative plan forming in his mind.
You know that gun won't work on me, small fry. Go home before I decide investing in you was an even bigger mistake than it was.
Michael waves his hand at Damien, in clear dismissal. Damien looks surprised for a second, his brow furrowing as if thinking hard.
It'll put you out. That's good enough. Have fun walking around with a dent in your head. You can remember who put it there.
Damien says, his grip tightening around the gun, but he is avoiding eye contact. In the gun is shaking.
He's completely bluffing,
thinks Michael.
Good.
Are you sure about that? He says aloud. After a second, the gun tips down to chest height.
I'm impressed. I didn't know you were this stupid, he says,
putting his hands in his pockets. Damien continues to stare at him, now definite unsurety on his face.
But are you sure it's your best move? Using a weapon you know won't kill me,
asks Michael. And Damien bites his lip. In a moment of pure nerve, Michael drops the backpack where he stands and walks toward him, keeping a neutral face. Damien does not fire the gun as Michael continues to approach him, eventually pressing his chest to the barrel.
Here you are. I've made it easy for you,
Michael says, grinning wolfishly again. Go on then. Shoot, little man. Eyes wide with disbelief, Damien doesn't respond. The barrel starts to quake against his chest, the cold metal turning warm from his body heat.
If you even put one bruise on me,
make sure your own mother doesn't recognize what will be left of your body. For a frightening moment, Michael thinks Damien will call the bluff. The seconds tick by in thick silence. 1, 2, 3, 4. Damien's expression shifts to submission, the flicker of boldness snuffed out. Michael takes a moment to be grateful that so little is known about people with his abilities. Michael relaxes and withdraws an old-fashioned lighter with wood inlay and a peculiar symbol of curved lines burned into it. Damien immediately backs up a few paces until Michael shushes him soothingly. He meets his eyes. He whispers small reassurances to him until Damien steps back toward him.
Just trying to bury the hatchet. Still need a light?
But Damien eyes him suspiciously.
Come on, man. I ain't a dumbass,
he says, though he doesn't step away. Michael shrugs and continues to hold up the lighter with a friendly smile.
You and I are sandbox brothers, Damien. I know it hurts, but I know you'll know the truth of this soon.
This pain?
It can only get better one way. Once you start the doses, you have to keep going until it does its work. Trust me. If you've reached your limit, though, I get it.
Damien's gaze searches Michael's face, and after a moment, he slowly pulls out the cigarette from his pocket. He holds it up as a gust of wind blows through the alley. Michael holds the lighter in one hand as the other blocks the wind. Damien puts the cigarette between his lips and leans forward to put it over the igniter. He doesn't even have time to flinch. In a smooth motion, Michael seems to catch the flame, spread it in his hand, and grab Damien around the face, four flaming fingers on one side of his jaw, and Michael's thumb clenched tightly on the other side. Damien tries to pull away and scream, but to no avail. Michael pulls him closer until their faces are separated by inches.
You're a pathetic, shit-faced moron. You always will be. Remember who you're speaking to, ghetto boy. I'll do business with anyone, but no human will ever get away with pointing a gun at me. Remember this every time you look in the mirror.
He growls as Damien passes out from the pain. Michael lets go of him. A red shadow is on Damien's face now, with five circles of horrid-looking burns that will never fully heal. The smell of the burns permeate the air around him. Michael hesitates, unsure of what to do. Almost of its own accord, the lighter ignites, and Michael's hand reflexively catches the flame again.
Perhaps some more decoration to keep him in line is required, he thinks.
Flashes dance across his mind. He hears a small voice in his head screaming at him to stop. He sees himself and Damien playing on the playground as kids. He remembers laughing with Damien as they walk home together. He remembers Damien talking Michael up to a girl at the bar. And Michael's hands pause. The rings on his hand, for a moment, go ice cold before a wave of hatred runs through him and the rings blaze warm. Adult drunken Damien in his former full health pulling a screaming prostitute down the alley. Adult Damien shooting a cop after witnessing a gang execution.
Not caring that it was his father.
Michael grits his teeth as his hand continues toward Damien's face, the flames gaining more life. He is going to kill him. He can't have Damien telling his secret. He can't have Damien thinking he's weak. A black glare passes Michael with the sound of low, rumbling thunder. Michael throws the still unconscious Damien toward the wall. In the same motion, he reaches the flamed hand toward the blur, but she is gone again. The rings on his fingers seem to pulse with his anger as it radiates through him like the fire in his blood.
Michael whirls around, trying to find the woman, because he knows who it is now. He sets his face in a malevolent snarl.
What is she doing here?
Finally, he sees her, leaning against a wall. Her hood is still up, and she is staring at him, her eyes narrowed.
The stench of your disapproval is worse than his burned flesh, cows, he says.
And as she continues to glare at him, Michael's rings heat to a scalding point.
Hey guys, thank you so much for listening to episode 4 of The Sanctum. I hope you guys are enjoying the story as much as I am, because I really do love these characters and I love bringing them to life. As always, keep an eye out for episode 5 coming up here hopefully pretty soon. Work has been a little bit hectic for me lately, so I'm a little bit slower in producing content as I would like, but keep an eye out as always. Thank you so much. All hail nerds.